area is impacted by human activities, including from fisheries and pollution. Now, our global system is actually our global system is the primary driver of biodiversity loss, and close to 90% of the world's marine fishes stocks are fully exploited, overexploited, or depleted. And our global food system is a primary driver of biodiversity loss, with agriculture alone being the identified threat to 24,000 of the 28,000 species at risk of extinction. Now, agricultural expansion is said to account for about 70% of the projected loss of terrestrial biodiversity. And around 3.2 billion people, or 40% of the global population, are adversely affected by land degradation. And about 25% of global greenhouse gas emissions are generated by land clearing, crop production, and fertilization. Now, declines in nature and the biodiversity at current trajectories will undermine progress towards 35 out of 44 of the targets of SDGs related to poverty, hunger, health, water, cities, climate, and oceans, as well as land. Now, the relationships and influences between drivers of biodiversity, ecosystems, dietary quality, nutrition, and health status has been mentioned earlier. And I just like to pinpoint that our biodiversity in food system affects actually the dietary quality and food security, as well as nutrition and health, that will bring about malnutrition in all its forms. And we know very well that malnutrition is actually driven by environmental factors such as water and sanitation, climate change, and biodiversity loss. And also demographic and sociocultural factors like the place of residence, that's actually including rural or urban area, educational level, especially the parents, behavioral risk factors, and the healthcare access. With regards to economic factor, we have household wealth income. In the Philippines, we call this actually the wealth quintile, and the food access and food security, as well as economic growth. Now, the global burden of malnutrition is really alarming, and you can see that 38 million children under 5 years old are actually overweight and obese. 131 million children aged 5 to 9 years old are overweight, and 207 million of adolescents are overweight, and about 2 million adults are overweight and obese. And with regards to actually anemia, about 613 million have anemia, and about 144 million children under 5 age are stunted, and about 47 million children under 5 age are wasted, and 20.5 million babies are born with low birth weight. Now, this was presented earlier, between 702 and 828 million people were affected by hunger globally in 2021, and more than half of people in the world affected by hunger in 2021 were actually located in Asia, and more than one third is actually in Africa. Now, the overview of Philippine biodiversity, we know very well that Philippines is one of the most important centers of amphibian and reptile diversity in Southeast Asia. And for water, we have the watersheds, and aquifers could supply about 479 BCM annually for domestic, industrial, and agricultural uses. And for pharmaceuticals, plants are used for common illnesses like cough, pain, tooth decay, and other diarrhea. Just like when we had the COVID-19, we use our plants to actually ease the symptoms of COVID-19, like what we call the sambong here. And food, every square kilometer of coral reefs can supply up to 30 tons of edible and economically important fish every year, and the biomass fuels. Now, if you can see, that the, our green economy of the Philippines about it composes about 29.6 million hectares, and most actually of these are actually agricultural, and the next is actually forest and brush and bruces and shrubs. And we also have open forest, about of the forest that we have, about 67% are open. And the Philippines has a unique biodiversity, and it has actually have endangered species also. Now, the degradation of the Philippine biodiversity will result actually to unsustainable production and consumption. And that's actually the impact on our green economy, because about 8 million hectares of forest land has been lost due to mining, lodging, and land conversion since the 1950s. And about 98.939 hectares of agricultural lands were approved for land conversion from 1988 to 2016. You can see a lot of skyscrapers in Metro Manila, and even already in the different highly urbanized cities of the Philippines. Now, about 13.2 million hectares of degraded soil due to pollution, deforestation, agricultural practices, industrial activities, and mining. With regards to our blue economy, now the total fisheries production, fish production for the period of January to December was posted at 4,250.79 metric tons. In 2021, fish production exhibited about a reduction of about 3.4% loss from previous year's production. And you can see here that we have lots also. However, there was a declining trend in the production. Now, the contribution of fisheries to domestic seafood consumption. So there is actually a decline from 1993 to 2018 National Nutrition Survey, because our agency conducts regularly the National Nutrition Survey. And most seafood is consumed as fresh, with processed fish, crustaceans, and mollusks accounting for a smaller proportion of seafood consumption. Now, we have actually also illegal, unreported, and unregulated unregulated fishing impact on our blue economy. And Philippines places 20th in global illegal fishing index. So the state of food production in the Philippines is declining. And you can see the trend from 2010. That's actually the Philippine Statistics Authority. And you can see here that the commercial fish has been declining also. And also at the municipal and aquaculture communities. And the relationship between population growth and fish catch in the Philippines is actually inverse. And you can see that as the population increases, our fish supply is decreasing. Sorry for this. So it's actually decreasing. And the declining employment share and consistent poverty in agriculture is the one also pushing those who are in the marginalized population, putting critical our biodiversity. And the state of the Philippines decreasing self-sufficiency in agriculture commodities and growing import dependency is also one of our biggest problems. And you can see the different countries where our food here in the Philippines are being imported. In our survey, household food security by residents and wealth quintile, you can see here that our food secure households way back in our survey in 2022 was actually 44%, and that's actually the food secure households. And what is very worse here is actually the severely food insecure, about 13%. And the poorest population are the most food insecure population, and they are actually found in the rural area. Now you can see that about the mean one-day household food consumption and percent contribution of key food groups, you can see that rice and cereals occupies the bulk of our meal or of the food consumed in our diet. And very few comprises actually the, if you can see, only fish, meat, and poultry, about 22%. And for vegetables, about 15%, 9% for 4.9 or 5% for our green leafy vegetables. Now, what is very glaring here is our fruit consumption, which is only about 4%. It's very far from our WHO recommendation. And the diversity among Filipino school age children from rural area and poor wealth quintile have less diverse diet. And you can see in our graph that our rural population are really the most affected population. And they are actually the poorest also. And there is also a decreasing intake of energy-giving foods in our population. As from our 1978 survey down to the 2018-2019 survey, there was really a declining trend of cereals and cereal products, starchy roots and tubers. And also our fruits and vegetables for meat and poultry. And for energy intake in the Philippines, it is very inadequate. And you can see that if we compare with our Philippine recommended dietary standards, we did not really meet our recommendation. And only about 31% have adequate energy intake. And the malnutrition trends, of course, that's the result of loop production, or that's the result of our biodiversity loss also. And you can see that there's a double burden of malnutrition, and also the underweight and stunting, wasting and overweight are really occurring tremendously as an alarming percentages. And for our pregnant women, we have about 16% who are nutritionally at risk, including our overweight lactating mothers is also increasing. And among our adults 20 to 59 years old, overweight is very high. And for our elderly also, why overweight is very high? It's just because they consume a lot of less nutrient dense foods. Now, examples of targeted measures to maximize our co-benefits. So we have to maintain and enhance crop diversity to support more diversified diet. We have to implement seed sector frameworks that support indigenous crop varieties. We are starting this already in the different areas. And we design food systems that are nutrition sensitive and place a value in biodiversity. This is actually included in our Philippine Plan of Action for Nutrition, for the nutrition sensitive indicators. Enhanced pest disease and weed controls and integrated pest management, improving soil health management, and promoting and enhancing sustainable production and consumption of local food. So we call this the indigenous vegetables and fruits. We also promote the use of ecosystem-based approaches and managing and restoring vegetation in the different catchments. No? We have to promote the sustainable management of freshwater systems and coastal fish habitats. They are, our government is actually already developing regulations on this. Improve fish post-harvest methods to reduce waste and revive food cultures. Making healthy local foods accessible and desirable to school-age children. That's actually one of our functions at the age in our institute, to actually use agricultural products for supplementary feeding of our school kids. And for example, our Nutribans, we use the squash to make Nutribans. Promoting education on nutritional value of locally sourced foods. And strengthening surveillance and monitoring. We have to actually do a lot of these because this is where we are weak. And creating healthy, sustainable, and equitable food value chains. Now, moving forward toward sustainable and healthy diets and food system, of course, there is a need to integrate biodiversity for nutrition and health, encourage policymakers to mainstream nutrition and dietary considerations. Currently, we are always invited in Congress or in the Senate to actually provide evidence-based data for our policymakers in developing evidence-based bills or laws. Now, improve existing policies. Yes, we are actually continuously trying to analyze our existing policies and make it more, enhance it up for better implementation. And consumer behavior changes. We have a lot of messages that we have developed, and it is also posted in our institute's website in order for people to know to actually browse and get some simple messages regarding nutrition and health. Application of agroecological regenerative approaches of procedures to promote biodiversity conservations. Our Department of Agriculture is taking good care of this. And of course, education, and we have to involve actually developmental organizations. So with this, I'd like to thank you very much. This is the Food and Nutrition Research Institute FASAD. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Imelda, for the very comprehensive presentation. We have time for questions.
I have a question that was also dealt with yesterday and this morning. How much is the concern for the sustainability of the system in other countries? Because we are very well aware of the difficulties we have in Europe, but we have no idea of what happens in other countries. And the Philippines might be a very different country from Europe.
Imelda, could you hear the question?
Yes, trying to look at the cost of improving the biodiversity, I don't have any idea at this time, but let me explore this and ask the different agencies like the Department of Agriculture, which the Bureau of Fisheries belongs, as well as the green economy of the Philippines is actually under them.
We have another question coming.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. Do you hear me?
Yes, okay. It's very clear, thank you.
Okay, let me ask you a few questions regarding your presentation. As you told us that 98.39% lands are changed, agricultural lands are changed. So that in what forms of those lands are changed? To which form? This is my first question. Second question. Illegal fishing is higher in Philippines. You said that. What are those illegal activities? Those activities which to be said as illegal. Third question, in rural area of Philippines, there is shortage of food diets. What do you think that there is in, when you compare with the urban people, why the rural people face food shortage? What do you think? Thank you.
Yeah. Can you please repeat the first question? Is actually the land conversion?
Yes.
Yeah. So the agricultural lands are actually converted to residential place. And because since the inputs of agriculture here is somewhat not yet, you know, some it's more of a problem because it's somewhat expensive. So the farmers or those who own the lot or land must prefer to actually sell it to you know, those who are building condos or apartments in the Philippines. So it's actually converted to residential. And for the illegal fishing, I said that it's just because, yes, it's well known, no, that our terrestrial waters is very rich in aquaculture, and a lot of fish are abound in that in our terrestrial areas. There are actually there's a use of illegal method. That's actually the dynamite, and also illegal fishing, because some people actually do it the unregulated way. No. I cannot say it. Like for example, the Chinese go to our seashore to catch fish, and these are actually already being sold by our government through negotiations and discussions with different nations involved.
Okay.
Why rural area are the most affected? It's just because, of course, of their lack of their low purchasing power. We know very well that those who are in the rural area have less opportunity to work, except that they go to farm, and they are the most marginalized population. Purchasing power is very low.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions? I have one for you, Imelda. I mean,
yes, sir.
There is always a discussion about the fact that our global diet is too dependent upon a very limited number of crop species. Are there in the Philippines attempts at utilizing new species that could be domesticated quickly to turn them into crops? So by taking direct advantage of the biodiversity that you have available or not?
There are actually moves already, but by different organizations. Like for example, our International Institute for Rural Reconstruction, they are actually promoting already indigenous products to actually grow in our areas. And there are a lot more organizations trying to actually propagate those products or plants that easily grow in our country to diversify our food supply. And because of our large population, there's really a need for us to really not only diversify, but also increase the volume of production in order to feed most of our Filipino population.
Thanks a lot. So thank you. We have another question from the floor. And if there are questions for Nicoleta, this is the time to ask them.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to follow up on what the previous question. One of the major problems, I think, affecting a number of countries which are centers of origin of biodiversity is the so-called biopiracy, genetic products and knowledge, traditional knowledge, is used by big companies, patented, and sold back to the countries of origin. Are the Philippines enacting some protective laws concerning that? I mean, I have the example of Indonesia, in which you cannot take a sample, even a liver sample, as Professor Tiribelli knows very well, out of the country, because they don't allow any organic material to leave the country. Are the Philippines having similar regulations? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, the Philippines have that regulations also, wherein the different flora and fauna here are not actually allowed to get out from the country. in the same manner that we they actually also control the incoming of the different species in the Philippines, because this might actually contaminate our existing biodiversity.
Thank you. Lala, c'è la... This is a question for the previous speaker, Imelda, sorry.
Yes, it is. So I found it very interesting, the question of defining quantitatively what is sustainability. So like if you want to compare, for instance, you were saying regular milk with plant-based beverages, you first of all have to define what you want to quantify as sustainability. And then a second step is also how you measure it. Because you were telling us that if you measure it with volume, you have one result. And if you measure the quantity of proteins, you have the opposite result if you want to compare them. So like, is there someone that is trying to bring up a definition of sustainability, which is taking into account all the different aspects? And so is a measure, is a quantity that can be measured in different contexts, but let's say in a uniform way, so you don't change the definition of what you're measuring from one study to the other, so that you can actually compare them. And the second question, which is more specific, is in that diet that was proposed by how was it
the Lancet Commission?
Yeah, the Lancet diet, exactly. So does it happen sometimes that sustainability is not a good proxy for healthy food? So is it always the case that what is sustainable is also healthy? And if it is not the case, how do you weight something sustainable and something healthy in the definition of this diet? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. I can start with the second one that is easier for me. They combined the nutritional requirement and also the effect of food food group on healthy and the prevention of non-communicable disease and so on with the sustainability. So they merge these two aspects that of course are most important to define a sustainable healthy diet. So this means that the quantity in their idea that they suggested are healthy and sustainable. So in the same way. So because they consider two aspects and combine them. For the first question, to the best my knowledge, I would say no, there is not a definition, because of course you can use different approaches, for example, different functional units, but also different life cycle stages. So some are for cradle to retail or gate, some are from cradle to the plate, that was the case of meat alternatives. So of course, it is difficult to compare the results and to have a final answer of what is sustainable.
No, I mean, I am aware that it is a very high shot to try to define sustainability in a unique manner, but this is somehow a source of frustration for me, being a theoretical physicist and also having some knowledge about statistics, because I mean, if you define differently a quantity, you can literally prove something or the contrary of it. So like if you define sustainability in a certain way, you can prove that electrified vehicles are more sustainable than regular ones. If you define it in another way and you take into account, for instance, the extraction of rare earth materials, it can be sometimes that this is not the case, or it's at least something that it's not easy to demonstrate. So even in food, I guess, it depends on what you measure and how you measure it.
Definitely.
And so you can compare two studies that are proving different, even opposite statements. But the point is not that they are wrong or they are contradicting each other, but they're just measuring something different.
Yeah, I would say that now is you can solve or try to solve that aspects using a homogeneous database. So we have now some good that data set of, for example, carbon footprint or gas emission, greenhouse gas emission. And you can use that because they sort all the data, they try to combine all the data based on similar approaches. So that could be a solution, of course. And usually to evaluate the sustainability of a diet, you use this database that is are improving because we use and the study I showed that we use a database that now is definitely improved. And so in this case, of course, there are uncertainty range because of course, different studies are collected and so on. But in this case, you can have a good idea about the sustainability of the diet.
I would like to add one element. I think you have to bear in mind that the health benefit attributes are, I wouldn't say necessarily fixed, but they have a narrow range of variation, while the sustainability profile of the production of a food has a huge range of variation. So it's much easier to define what we should eat to have a healthy diet and then try to refocus the production systems towards producing that food in the most sustainable manner. And bear in mind that sustainability, even if we talk only about environmental sustainability, which is what we have been mostly talking about, is made of many different components: greenhouse gas emission, biodiversity loss, water consumption, and so on. So even just building a combined index would not be easy because you would need to choose what weight to give to each of these components. But then on top of that, and that's something that we haven't discussed much, there is also social sustainability and economic sustainability, which should all go into the equation. But you physicists are able to solve complex equations, so that's why we're here.
Well, thank you, the first speaker. I would like to ask, when is frying ever a good method of cooking? Because I learned it's a source of vitamin E in frying food. Is there any truth in that?
Sorry?
I said, when is frying of food? When is it ever a good method of cooking? Is it ever a good method of cooking? Because I learned vitamin E is actually...
No, probably not
the sourced best from frying.
Probably not the best cooking method. I study a lot the cooking methods, different cooking methods on, for example, vitamin C and bioactive compounds in vegetables. And I would say that, for example, carrot, the best cooking method is boiling because you can release the beta carotene from the structure. And so if you add also oil, you can have the maximum bioavailability of these compounds, so pro-vitamin A. But in case, for example, of broccoli, would better to steam than boiling, because otherwise the, for example, vitamin C or other compounds can be leached in the water. So is quite complicated.
So there's no truth in sourcing vitamin C E from frying.
Vitamin, I don't have a big experience on that, sorry. But,
I would suggest that you continue the discussion during the break because we have to have coffee break. Please join me in thanking both speakers for their excellent presentations, and we meet again at 10:30 for the next session.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Imelda.
Thank you. Bye-bye.